not many people get to talk with a legend. However, I was very fortunate to have the opportunity to talk with a living legend, to learn a lot of little-known facts about his life, how he grew up on a farm in East Texas, and becomes one of the best-known country musicians ever to draw a bow across a fiddle string. I invite you to share with me now the life story of a living legend, Bob Wills.
With a little, I know that's had to come sometime. Let's get it over with.
Oh, I always did like to do that, Bob. Well, I tell you what, let's start out in the beginning. First of all, where and when were you born?
Oh, you said when. That where would have been all right, but when you put it when, that's getting way back. But anyway, I was born in East Texas. We call it East Texas, kind of Southeast Texas, Limestone County. 2 miles out from a little town called Cossey, Log House.
And you never told us when.
Well, 1906.
1906.
That's right.
Bob, tell us about some of the things that happened to you before you became a professional musician. I know a lot of folks would be interested in this.
Well, since I'm more or less up in the territory where I was practically raised, I know I'll hit a lot of old-timers, I think we will, that will remember a lot about it. I've spent several years down between the rivers, just out from Memphis. Memphis, of course, is the county seat of Hall County, 12 miles in southwest of Lakeview, down between Big Red and Little Red, as we said.
Mm-hmm.
And we was farmers, and farming that sandy land, we had 500 acres. We worked from 36 to 40 mules, and, of course, a lot of help. But we done that for lots of years. Yeah, I bet you wouldn't guess in 100 years my hobby.
Well, Bob, what was your hobby back then?
Well, it's funny. We always worked these little light Mexico mules, we called them. Mm-hmm. And my hobby in the spring of the year was breaking these mules. I used to insist on my dad selling the ones we already had broke, you know, and go buy a bunch of, well, young ones.
Uh-huh.
And my kick was to break these mules.
So that was when you were a young man, your hobby was breaking mules.
Well, I'd say it was strictly my hobby because I was crazy about it.
Uh-huh. Well, I tell you what, let's move on up a little bit now and talk about when you first started playing music.
Well, if we're gonna, we can put it two ways. Professionally, it was the year of 28. But lots of years before that, I played a little mandolin with my dad, and we played all those ranch dances, or other dances too, but all those headquarters, a lot of big ranches down in there. And I played a little mandolin following him, just, you know, to accompany him. And then in 28, I went into medicine show business. You know, I was blackface comedian.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm so thankful that due to the fact I guess I could do several little old things, not none of them good, but I could do them. I could dance, I could sing, and I'm pretty good on telling stories and then play the fiddle. And it wasn't over 6 months, there's a blackface that I was rated as number one in Texas. That's moving up pretty fast against some of the old boys like old Gasaway, and I can't think of some of the others now, I'm sorry.
Well, that's really moving up there fast.
Well, it really was, but I was very lucky, and it's because I could do so many little things like that, you know. Take up all you need to do in medicine show is fill in time.
Right. But you first started professionally in a medicine show in blackface, and when did you organize your first band, Bob?
Well, now there's another problem. I was a barber, you know. I went to Dendy's Barber College right here in Amarillo.
Well, this is something I didn't know.
Yeah, I really barbered off and on, biggest part of the time, 5 years. Just learning it when I really pulled out. But I guess I've had, you couldn't call it an organized band, but I've had a guitar player, a mandolin player, that I could put my finger on ever since I was 12 or 13 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I lived in Roy, New Mexico, nearly 2 years. And when I moved up there, I had a band, so-called a band. You wouldn't call it a band, but we did, you know. Mm-hmm. I had them where I put my finger on them. We could get a little job, we'd go play it.
Right, and the first big organized band that you ever started with was what, Bob?
Well, Lycrus Doughboys.
Mm-hmm.
However, I already had a band there. A couple of years, I'd say, before we got into that.
Mm-hmm.
But finally, we got a chance at this Doughboy program, which was quite a thrill for us, you know. And that's every day, 15 minutes, every day, just 15 minutes, but taking a lot of work on that thing. We had a regular Doughboy studio down Burroughs Mills, an elevator company. And we just went down there like a regular job, morning to 8 o'clock. Stayed till 4:30 in the afternoon.
From 8 till 4:30?
Yeah, just sitting there. We didn't work all the time. We was thinking and playing a victrola and learning tunes.
Right.
Things like that.
Well, that was the days with the Lycrus Doughboys, and that was really popular on radio, and I guess that was just about nationwide, too.
Well, we I'm the first one ever hit a lick on what's known as the Texas Quality Network.
Right.
We started that. O'Daniel set that up. Of course, that is the three big stations, WOAI and KPRC and WBAP in Fort Worth. And I'll tell you what we did. We done a program in honor of Jimmy Rogers when he passed on.
Yes.
And it's been said, it's in the Fort Worth Star-Telegram. They tell me you can still go get the paper I had. I lost a scrapbook I had it in. We received 50,000 letters on that one program. Can you imagine? We've taken them out of the studio in 98-pound flour sacks. That's really the truth.
That must have really been a thrill for you.
Well, it really should have been, but I don't think I was smart enough to realize, you know. But that's lots of mail.
Right. Well, Bob, let's move on up to the Western Playboys now.
Oh, you mean Texas Playboys?
I mean the Texas Playboys.
Well, after I lost that job, I went to Waco. I stayed about 6 months. But something kept pulling me to Oklahoma, because out of all of this mail we received from day to day, we'd have to go through it with O'Daniel and sort it out and read it and all that kind of thing. Most of my mail come from Oklahoma, our mail, I'd say. And I had a desire to go to Oklahoma. Well, I went to Oklahoma City and sat down for a week. WKY was getting along pretty good. In other words, I had dances booked, set up. O'Daniel had us throw it off of that station. And so we was debating then whether to go back to San Antonio. They wanted us down there, or going up to Tulsa, and I kept pulling for Tulsa. And we moved into Tulsa. It's KVOO in 34. And we almost stayed on as long as Breakfast Club. You know, we stayed on there lots of years. Of course, I left way back, I guess, 42 or 3, right in there, and went out to California. And John and Lee picked it up and just held it, you know. I left the band with him. And we was on that station lots of years.
Right. Well, and then about this time you were doing a lot of traveling on the road.
About this time we was flat traveling every day except Sunday. Mm-hmm. I barred Sunday. I wouldn't work on Sunday until I got with MCA, and when you get with MCA, you work.
Well,
you work.
You worked for many years with a gentleman by the name of Tommy Duncan.
Yeah, I sure did.
And
a great guy.
Certainly
hardest working guy I ever seen in my life.
And when did you first join up with Tommy Duncan?
Well, I'll tell you. Milton Brown and myself started this thing. He was a cigar salesman, and we were just accidentally, I guess you'd call it kind of accidentally, pals. We were just pals. There's no way in the world around it. And we done a lot of private dances and a lot of private things around Fort Worth before we got in as Doughboys. But Melton's with me a long time there as a Doughboy. And finally, O'Daniel stopped us from playing dances out at Crystal Springs. And Durwood Brown was working with us. And Melton just wasn't making enough at Burles Mills as a doughboy to support the family. His father and mother's kind of old. So he had to pull out in order to keep Durwood working, you understand? And so when he went out, that's when Tommy come in. I tried 67 singers before I lit on Tommy.
67?
Just think, I drove every place I'd hear of a singer, I'd go try him.
Mm-hmm.
And finally wound up Tommy coming to my house. Yes, sir.
Just walked in on you.
Well, he first called, but I had him mixed up with another guy.
Right.
But I said, come on out and we'll see. And it's a funny thing, Emmett Miller, years ago, my favorite song, and I Ain't Got Nobody.
Right.
And Tommy hadn't been there 5 minutes till I said, well, there's one question I want to ask you. If you can do that, you're hard. Can you sing I Ain't Got Nobody? He said, that's my favorite. I said, let's hear you get after it. And he done, I said, you're hard.
Bob, now let's talk some about your recordings and your record. What was the first recording you ever made, Bob?
I'll never forget it, because I picked the hardest one we had ever done in our lives. I said, if we get through this one, we ought to go through it pretty easy. And mm-hmm. We worked nearly a day on it, Osage Stomp.
The Osage Stomp, that would have been an instrumental.
Yeah, and it's da-dee-da-dee-da-bum-bum. Was our first tune right there.
The first recording, and after this, of course, we could sit here and name song after song that you have recorded, and of course, I guess some of the most popular, San Antonio Rose, Home in San Antonio.
Yeah, San Antonio Rose nicely was the top, but I'll tell you the closest one to it was Trouble in Mind.
Trouble in Mind.
Nobody knows that much, and they thought it was ours that we done it. Well,
right.
We didn't. It had already been recorded.
It had.
But ours caught on.
You wrote San Antonio Rose.
Yeah, sure did.
And when
it's
was...
It's a steal from Spanish Two-Step.
It is.
Yeah, old Uncle Art Southerly, last resident of Columbia Records. We put on this Spanish Two-Step first, instrumental, of course.
Right.
Next time I went back, he said, Bob, he's an Englishman. Give me another Spanish Two-Step. You got one? I said, we sure have. And boys began to look at each other. I said, we haven't got one. I said, oh yeah, we'll just play Spanish Two-Step backwards. And they looked, what I actually meant, see, I started Spanish Two-Step in A and throwed it to Leon, Mike Collins, and he went to A. Well, I was in A, he went to D on the bridge part of it.
Right.
Well, what I had in mind, I'd start one in D
and then go
and
to
let
A.
Him go to A.
Uh-huh.
And they didn't know what in the world I meant backwards. And do you know how much time was spent on the music part of San Antonio Rose?
How much time is that?
I doubt if there's 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
5 minutes. I doubt very seriously if there's 5 minutes, because we run over it about the second time. He said, that sounds good, Bob. We wasn't ready, but I said, okay, let's catch it.
And you recorded San Antonio
Rose.
He named it.
He come out. I thought, how silly can a man be? Call, more or less, close to a breakdown, San Antonio Rose. But he wanted to call it that, and I didn't argue with him. Then later on, put the words to it.
Right. So this is one of
Everett
the greatest.
Stover helped me put the words to it.
Mm-hmm.
He was my announcer and trumpet man.
Well, Bob, this just about brings us up to just nearly to the present day. It's been the same ever since then, hasn't it? On the road and cutting records, and I imagine a lot of ways it's been a real great life. You've met a lot of great people.
Well, I've met a lot of great people. I really love people. That is no if and ands. However, you take... I'm going to say close to 40 years in the business. You I don't care who you are. It's just like taking an old racehorse back to the gates. He's going to get more nervous. Don't kid yourself. He's going to do it because I helped myself an awful long time, but I have a tendency to be a little nervous now.
Right.
After all these years. Mm-hmm. I really do. But I still love people. Love to try to entertain them.
And you have an awful lot of fans, Bob, let me tell you.
Well, I certainly hope so. You know, that's all you live for, really. You can go in. I can go into a dance. This has been a habit of mine. Of course, no need of anybody kidding to say they haven't had bad nights. The biggest, all of us has had bad nights. And if I can get just a few that's enjoying it, I've never let myself think about money or how many is in there. I've made it a point. If there's a few enjoying it, I'll work just as hard, maybe a little harder.
Yeah.
And that's one thing I've really copped. I'm pretty good at that. Just going ahead and enjoying playing three or four, you know?
Well, Bob, I guess you could say this is your life, being an entertainer and country music.
There's one other little thing I want to tell you. I guess it is. But used to, my dad would tell me in the cotton patch or chopping cotton, whatever he's doing, to go unhook and clean up and rest a little bit. We're going over and play so-and-so headquarters at some Let's Ranch or someplace. And I knew it was all night. I knew it was all night. We'd stop midnight and have supper. But I knew it was all night. Well, you know, that's pretty hard on a kid. I mean, a little kid. And I used to go in crying and tell my mother, when I grow up to be a boss of my own, I'll never step my foot in the dance hall as long as I live. So I'm going to say to everybody, it don't pay to say what you won't do, because you're liable to wind up doing that very thing. But I did. I used to do that. Because it's so hard on me, you know. I used to drop the pick, and that finger still got scars on it from keep playing, you know.
Right.
Blood running down on that little mandolin. It's tough.
I imagine it was. But, Bob, how much longer do you, you're not going to retire. You're going to keep on as long as you can go.
Man, I want to keep eating. You know, I've made a lot of deals in these years.
Oh, but
I made a lot of deals.
Right.
I'm a dealer, and I'm not a dealer. I'm not a businessman. I say any entertainer better let somebody else do the business.
Right.
But I've done a lot of dealing, and I've made a lot of money at it.
Mm-hmm.
I've lost a lot. Well, but incidentally, it don't amount to nothing. Never would be a star. But you know, we made shorts and pictures, 36 of those. A lot of people don't know that. They think we made one or two or three.
Mm-hmm.
But we made 36 shorts and full-size westerns.
Right.
7-day wonders.
Well, Bob, let me ask you this question. How does it feel to be a living legend?
Well, actually, I don't know how to say it other than to put it this way. I have never realized anything only just liking people. Just the same as when I lived between the rivers and went out to a country dance and had a lot of fun. It's never made one ounce of difference in my feelings. So help me, I mean that. I don't know whether every guy can say that or not, but that's what I truthfully say. I feel just the same and just as, well, just as humble to folks as I did way back there when I was made to go to a dance. Yes, sir.
But you do enjoy it, and this has been your life.
It's been my life, let's face it, because, like I say, I do like people. And what tickles me more than anything in this world is to still get in a crowd of people. That's why I guess I like Texas so well. They do know what fiddling is.
Mm-hmm.
And it still thrills me for them to want to hear these fiddle tunes, you know?
Right.
You know, we do world of singing, you know, practically everything, but when a guy comes up and asks for one of the old-timers like Beaumont Rag, Lone Star Rag, Twinkle Little Star, or just name them, Brownskin Gal, it always gives you one feeling, because that fiddle is my life.
Bob,
silly.
Bob, every once in a while you can be convinced to sing a song or two, can't you?
I sing several little songs, but if I can get out of it, I wouldn't sing one of them. Not that I can sing good, but there is a few that won't hear you sing.
Right.
But I try to get around it. But my fiddle is my life.
Tell us about your first fiddle, Bob.
My first fiddle is right now in Nashville, Tennessee. My first fiddle. I don't know whether to say it wasn't really. It's my first, but I never did know whether it's mine or my dad's. Mm-hmm. He won it at a fiddling contest. But the first professional job that I ever played on my own was that fiddle. And nicely, I could have sent any fiddle down there. It would have been a fiddle. They just asked for a fiddle.
Right.
But I didn't feel like that was right. So I just spent $153 with Jimmy Meek out here fixing this old baby up.
Mm-hmm.
And it's down there now in this thing, you know, the... what?
The Country Music Hall of Fame.
Yeah, that's where it's at. And that's the first fiddle I ever played to myself to really... take money, get money from.
Right.
So I thought that was the fiddle ought to go down there.
Well, it certainly, I believe, is right.
It's a cheap fiddle, but it happened to be a great cheap fiddle, easy mm-hmm. to play. And I got a little hand, and the neck's just, I don't know how to say, a fraction shorter than a standard fiddle, and it just fit me. I really hate to do it, but I couldn't see myself sending a Sears and Roebuck fiddle down there. Right. You know, I didn't think it'd been fair.
Right. Well, this is just another way, I think. The country music fan will be there. And here, I think, again, you are thinking of that country music fan, Bob, and want to give them a part of you to see there.
Well, you know how you feel when you pin a thing down like that. It just wouldn't have been fair, now, would it, to just send a fiddle I'd went out here and paid $3-4 for, which would have answered the purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't want anything fine. But this old fiddle, I told my wife, I said, the only way in the world I can do it is just send this fiddle to live with myself.
Right.
So that's what I done. I sent an old fiddle. I hope a lot of people know that, because that is the old fiddle.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Well, Bob, to sort of sum things up, I would like to say this, and I'd like to, I don't quite know how to ask it, but I know, as we've said, country music has been your life for many, many years, and it is a hard life on the road.
It is. Let's face it. Now, there's no way in the world you can get around, because when you're on your toes, so much rehearsing has to be done. You know that if you keep up, and we used to keep up with the times. In fact, when I had that 20-piece band, we stayed way ahead of the big bands because they'd send these commercial music out, in other words, arrangements. And I've paid as high as $1,250 to have one of those rearranged, and we'd be playing them 3 months before they'd ever come over the networks.
Right.
And people used to come up plumb mad and say, I heard a band over the network playing your tune the other day.
Well, Bob, let me ask you this. As hard as the life is, a musician on the road all the time, away from home, all the hard work, and I imagine a lot of time there's a lot of heartbreak and disappointment. Let me ask you, what drives a person to keep on and keep going?
The folks, people, the people. You can go out so low, you can feel so low that you don't feel like you can even pick up a fiddle and a bow. And you walk out there, and those people are out there sitting in front of you smiling and are all there to have a good time. I don't know. Just does something to you. You can work with a fever 103. I have so many times. Fever as high as 103, maybe higher. But they bring you up. Just like, I guess, you put an old racehorse in that gate. When they open my gate, he's going to run. I may not win nothing, but I'm going to run.
So
that's the only way I know how to explain it.
It's the people and the satisfaction you get out of pleasing people.
Well, that's it. I started so young, you know, kid.
Right.
But another thing I want to tell you, I thought of it now. See, both grandfathers were fiddlers, and I don't mean they were pretty good fiddlers, good. My dad was a fiddler, 9 uncles was a fiddler, and 5 aunts.
And 5 aunts.
So, it's kind of runs in my blood, you know, to play
right.
fiddle.
And of course, your brothers are musicians too,
yeah.
and very well known too.
Well, they're great guys. The only thing is, I'll never say John's a fiddle player. Oh, it breaks his heart. He won't even hardly play a program if he knows I'm the country guy. But he's the greatest rhythm banjo man I ever heard. Luke's a great bass man. Billy Jack's good bass and wonderful drums. That covers them. They're all good. We're all country. I don't trying to put us too high, but they all lay that beat in there. You know?
They're all musicians, and it sounds like your family for years and years before you were musicians.
That's what I mean. Mm-hmm. They really were. Just think of it. 9 uncles. All of them played fiddle. See, I've had an uncle. He's passed on now. My mother's youngest brother. He had the rating of Texas number one fiddler for the last 3 or 4 years of his life. He's just white-headed and cute little fella, you know, and his action. And he was number one fiddler.
Well, Bob, it has been a pleasure having you with us on the program.
Well, thank you for saying that. Really appreciate it. It's wonderful, nice of you. And it's a funny thing. So many of the boys, disc jockeys, I guess we'll say. I was taught something as a youngster coming up, eating that cornbread and grease gravy. My dad used to say, if I got up big enough and I went to a dance on my own, he said, if I ever hear of you pushing yourself in or asking to play a tune, boy, you've had it. Don't ever go up to a fiddler and say, can I play a tune? Another thing, don't push yourself in any place. Well, years ago, and I used to travel with old Al Dexter and Tex Ritter and him, and going back across the country, well, the minute we'd hit a town, they'd grab up their little records, and here they'd go.
Mm-hmm.
And I was dumb, see. I thought I'd be pushing myself in on you guys. And I wouldn't do it, because I was taught different. And I've learned later, a lot of them dislike me, because they want to think maybe I think I'm too good to. And I was just taught and trained to not do a thing like that. And later on, now I'll have to back up and say I was completely wrong. The disc jockeys was glad to see him, accepted him, and everything. But that's where I missed the boat so much. Somebody ought to told me something, but they didn't.
Well, Bob, once again, it has been a pleasure. And
thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
I hope I haven't talked too much now and messed up your program. You suppose I have?
No, you never could talk too much, Bob. It's just a pleasure to hear something about your life.
Well, thank you. We just about opened the gate to all of it.
Well, thank you very much, Bob.
I'm Ken Hightower, and that's our story of Bob Wills. Bob Wills left us in 1975. This was a great loss to country music. However, Bob left us with a wealth of unforgettable country music that'll live on as long as a bow is drawn across a fiddle string at a country dance.